When Ryan Nelson brought his family with him to Huntsville, he painted them a picture of their new backyard.
It was kind of a wish of my children and a promise to them that when we moved here from New York 2 years ago, that I would build them a backyard playset that they could both use.
So he put in a slide and a climbing wall and a really big swing.
I wanted a glider design that Mary could drive on in her chair and not have to be transferred.
The thing about this structure is that Mary can power it.
She's a natural at it.
From the ground up, Ryan Nelson built a cornerstone of childhood. A chance to say, I can do it myself.
Really, in everything we do with Mary, we look to how we can give her independence.
In fairness, Ryan had some help. He won an online grant to help fund the construction, and his friend Destin Sandlin lent a hand too.
I saw that he was going to build a swing for his daughter, Mary, who's in a wheelchair.
He said, I'd love to come out and help you.
Ryan had everything planned out, and all I had to do was just, you know, hold boards and operate a screw gun where he told me to.
Destin made this time-lapse video of the experience. In fact, he makes a lot of videos. Destin runs a YouTube channel called Smarter Every Day. He's got more than 3 million subscribers. So a lot of people have seen Mary swing.
The Smarter Every Day Facebook page has about 750,000 people that follow it. And so I posted this video of Mary on the page and it went viral. It's got over 5 million views.
Does it work?
And that's how this backyard project, a chance for a kid to say, I can do it myself, turned into an opportunity to help people all over the world do the same.
One thing that was interesting is people started reaching out and they said, hey, I know someone that's in a wheelchair and they would love this.
And the Nelson family would love that.
We just want to spread that goodness to other people.
So even though this is a project built on independence, everyone involved is willing to admit they could use a hand now.
What I think would be cool is if we could get an engineering firm here in town to invest a little bit of time in drawing up some formal plans stamped by a professional engineer so that I could freely distribute the plans on the internet for other little boys and girls all over the world.
And that's just the first step.
Further down the road, we'd like to be able to grant a swing to a person who's deserving of it.
Now someone else has the chance to join in, to say, I can do it myself, to help make up some plans for this swing to spread around the globe. It's worth your effort, because Mary still remembers what she said the first time she got on that swing.
This is awesome!
David Kumbrock, WHNT News 19. With a thud of bodies hitting earth, all eyes turned to Madison. Shurasbhai Patel, thrown to the ground while on a walk in his neighborhood, can barely move now. The officer who hurt him, Eric Parker, finds himself recommended for termination, facing charges, local and federal. His string of court hearings and appearances is part of the new reality of police brutality investigations. A lot has changed in the last year. We can prove it without even leaving the county. Instead, we go across city lines and back in time to 2011.
Oh yeah, he's gonna pay for it.
Gary Wayne Hopkins sits in the back of a Huntsville police patrol car, arrested again for domestic violence. He's got a long rap sheet. A report from the city's Department of Human Resources sums up the night like this. Hopkins kicked out the patrol car's window and had to be moved. 2 new officers are called to the scene. They tell Hopkins what's going on. He seems compliant.
We're going to take you out and put you in leg session.
But when they go to execute the plan,
hey, Russell, go ahead.
Officer Russell moves in.
Go ahead.
The then interim police chief Lewis Morris recommends Officer Brett Russell be fired. The city council watches in 2012 what you're watching now.
I review those tapes at least about a dozen times each.
The city council first votes on another officer's brutality accusations. It votes to put PJ Lee, seen here, back on the force. Then it's Russell's turn. He's reinstated too.
I was amazed at the outcome of those cases.
But Will Culver's not just amazed as a council member.
I've worked approximately 10 years as a police officer. I've worked the first, second, third shift patrols. I did Special Operations Division.
Culver voted against Officer Lee, but when Lee was reinstated on a 3-2 vote, Culver felt Officer Russell should get the same treatment. Now, Officer Parker still hasn't had his review from the city of Madison, but he faced criminal charges within the week and federal charges several weeks after that. Back in 2011, local charges never came up for discussion at the Madison County Courthouse.
In that particular case, there was never any kind of investigation that was turned over to us to assess for prosecution.
Russell did eventually get indicted on federal charges for this incident in May of 2015. For contrast, it took 40 months to get that indictment. Parker's took 7 weeks. Jake Watson does defense work in his Huntsville office, and he says he's represented several people who have claimed abuse from police. He says the federal system just pays more attention now.
It seems that this Department of Justice that we have now is taking those allegations seriously, whereas in the past, I haven't seen these kind of intense investigations into wrongful police conduct.
Attorneys on both sides of the tug of war for justice that happens in this courthouse say nationwide protests have changed everything.
No justice, no peace.
I think that we're starting to see results of it.
Yeah, I've seen that.
Throughout the legal system,
I think there's much more sensitivity now.
And it's opening up new avenues for complaints against cops.
As a lawyer locally, I don't think anybody's ever really thought we need to go to the Department of Justice.
Our expectations for justice have changed a lot since 2011, since Officer Russell found his way back on the force.
I think that the same colleagues on the council may have made a different decision if we were presented with that case today.
And the Huntsville City Council might have some company in that regard. David Kumbrock, WHNT News 19. Let's start the lesson simply.
When a legislative body starts to make dramatic policy changes, follow the money.
The questions about this legislation are easy.
Who wins, who loses?
The answers are not. For starters, the bill calls for nonprofits to run charter schools. So how does money factor in? Well, the bill also allows those nonprofits to sign contracts, so taxpayer money can flow through charter schools and their students to corporations. One big business right now is distance or virtual education. The original charter bill text even specifically recognized virtual education as a possibility for charter schools. The current bill lists a bunch of other approaches, however.
They said, but it's not limited to these.
So if the bill passes, distance learning companies would have a whole new market of charter schools to sell their goods. But what in the world does all this have to do with the indictment of Alabama Speaker of the House Mike Hubbard? In short, the indictment alleges Hubbard took money from a distance learning company. I want to show you three exhibits that the state submitted in the massive data dump on the case. First, Exhibit 43. Here, we see Hubbard claiming desperate financial need. You see this all throughout the exhibits, but in this email from September 6, 2011, he specifically says, "As we discussed, I'm striving to be the best speaker in the United States. Perhaps I might need to scale back and be a slightly better than mediocre speaker in order to devote more time to supporting my family." Second, Exhibit 32. Hubbard shows up on the payroll of a distance learning company in early 2012 as a consultant. A leader at Edgenuity refers to a $7,500 a month financial commitment to Hubbard. Even by political standards, it stands out.
That's far more money than just a typical campaign contribution.
Third, Exhibit 58. Here, we see Hubbard committed to charter schools. Former Governor Bob Riley says to Hubbard in an email on June 28, 2012, "Heard our gov just nixed charter schools." Hubbard replies, "I am not going to quit on charter schools. I don't know why Bentley says stuff like that." The state submitted nearly 100 exhibits, boiling down to 23 charges against Hubbard. Count 10 focuses on the money he took from Edgenuity.
A consulting contract would be the kind of thing that would have been providing him with personal financial gain.
Of course, we can't know for certain what's behind the big push for charter school legislation this year, and there are probably a million forces at work here. But we do know that in a time where Mike Hubbard claimed to be in dire financial straits, court documents show a distance learning company showed up and paid him $7,500 a month for consulting.
That's about $250 a day, each day of each month. I think for the average Alabamian, that's a pretty good chunk of change. And I think human nature says that that much money would influence my behavior.
David Kumbrock, WHNT News 19. The internet churns like an ocean, a constant gurgle of cynicism and snark. But in July of 2015, NASA found a way to part the sea of sarcasm. Silence. Awe. For a split second, we took in our closest view ever of Pluto, and as one collective, the same breath we drew in to quip or criticize, we exhaled in wonder. In cyberspace, on a planet called Reddit, homeworld of the eye roll, the scientists behind the New Horizons project answered questions. One stands out, and it goes like this. I was born after the Voyager missions, and even though I was aware of other missions, to Saturn, to Mars, this is the first one to give me a tremendous sense of awe, about how big our solar system is, and about our ability to explore it. So thanks. My question is this.
My first daughter is being born in September, and I'm wondering what you think the first mission will be that will give her the same sense of wonder. What's coming down the pipe in the next 15 to 20 years or so?
NASA program scientist Kurt Niebuhr responds, "What a great question. I remember holding my newborn son as the first Cassini radar data from Titan was downlinked in the middle of the night. The next big mission that can grow up with your daughter is the Europa mission. This mission will investigate if Europa and its huge global ocean is habitable. Take her to the launch in the early 2020s
when she was about 8 years old, then watch the day to come in with her when she was a young teenager."
What better way to teach a child about science and space and perspective?
I've always been fascinated at how small we are.
Niebuhr knows that feeling. He grew up on the Voyager missions.
It was something that I started off watching as a small kid, just thinking, wow, this is cool. Aren't those pictures amazing? And by the time the encounters finish up, I was old enough to start reading more scientific books about what we learned.
Decades later, he helps oversee New Horizons as it teaches us about how tall the mountains are on Pluto. He watched as the faint blur of distant images grew into defined shapes and ridges and bodies. And now these markers of the farthest reach of human discovery mark moments in the life of his son, too.
One of my favorite things from the New Horizons mission was a poster that was created around launch, which was a growth chart where you could mark how tall your kids were getting as the years went on during cruise.
Commenter Matt Bolero knows the feeling of hurtling through life and space at the same time.
It just kind of lined up where in the past year, as the probe got closer and closer to Pluto, that my life started to change in dramatic ways. My wife and I got married last December, and we're expecting our first daughter in, or first child at all, our first daughter in September.
And now she'll have her own growth chart in the exploration of Europa. After all,
we don't do these missions just with science. We see on a daily basis how utterly amazing the universe is. And we want to share that with everybody.
With you and your children. Because we all deserve wonder. David Kumbrock, WHNT News 19.